Hi everyone. Today I want to talk about a book called The DevOps Handbook. But first, a vlog. I want to try this as a way of having regular talks about important software development topics. I have quite a few topics lined up, so I could potentially do this for quite a while. Let me know what you think, and I hope you enjoy it. So, why did I choose The DevOps Handbook? I bought the book when somebody told me they thought it was a complete guide on how to do software development. And recent events at Worth have made DevOps a very current topic for me, hence this vlog. The book was written by leading figures from the DevOps and continuous delivery movement, so I knew the content was going to be good, but I was surprised by how well written it was. It has a great balance between theory and practice. It talks about the three ways of DevOps at an almost philosophical level, but then it brings it back in, giving you concrete and practical advice. The book includes case studies that do a great job of explaining the why behind the DevOps practices. I also enjoyed the brief history of DevOps section. It sets the stage and it shows how many people have been involved over how many years in the software development industry that have contributed to the knowledge and the ideas in this book. I personally think it would be a shame if people in software development weren't at least aware of these ideas. To kick things off, let me read you the first paragraph of the introduction. Imagine a world where product owners, development, QA, IT operations, and InfoSec work together not only to help each other, but also to ensure that the overall organization succeeds. By working towards a common goal, they enable a fast flow of planned work into production, while achieving world-class stability, reliability, availability, and security. There are four things there. Multiple disciplines working together, a common goal of making sure the entire organization succeeds, there's the concept of flow, and of course, high quality. Those things together are the goal. The entirety of it, that's what you could conceivably call DevOps. So if that's DevOps, then the DevOps engineer role starts to sound a bit weird. Could adding a single DevOps engineer to your team achieve all of that? That role is a crucial part of the process, but it's only a small part. There's way more to it. There's a case study in the book about how the vice president of engineering at Google coined the term site reliability engineer. That job title has gained a lot of traction in the industry. And it's not just because of that that I think we need to start using that term, but it's also because it avoids the trap of thinking that DevOps is anything less than an organization-wide effort. You may have noticed that business analysis and design weren't in that list of disciplines, but they are mentioned throughout the book. The DevOps ideas tend to focus more on the things that happen during and after development. I briefly mentioned the three ways of DevOps. They are flow, feedback, and continuous learning. In this video, I want to focus in on flow. If you're familiar with lean principles, or the concept of a value stream, you're going to recognize a lot of what I'm about to say. The lean movement that has had a big influence on DevOps developed concepts that were applied to industrial manufacturing in the 1980s. But with DevOps, now we apply them to software engineering. In manufacturing, the lean concepts have more than proven themselves. They're able to lower costs and accelerate delivery. So what does that mean for software development? How do we optimize the flow in the software value stream, going from development to operations to the customer? There are a lot of practices in this book, and I'm only going to focus on a few of them. I've decided to focus on the ones that are explicitly not technical in nature. I'm doing that on purpose, because DevOps and automation are very strongly associated in most people's minds. However, the practices that I'm going to talk about are equally, if not more important, than the technology-based solutions. Let's get into it. The practices of flow. 1. Make work visible. This is foundational. Using work tracking systems is commonplace, but using it diligently and in specific ways is very important for the practices that will follow. 2. Limit work in progress. Software development is dynamic. Priorities are adjusted almost daily, and usually the current task dominates the conversation. Context switching is constant, and a lot of communication is necessary to align and realign the team. This is costly. In manufacturing, interruptions are painfully visible, so people avoid them. Not so much in software development. Extended periods of focus are very rare. Interrupting development or testing work in progress doesn't look at the face of it like it's expensive, but it is. Without a constraint on the number of items of work in progress, everyone's focus will be spread thinly. By limiting the amount of work that's allowed to be in progress, we can stop starting and start finishing. 3. Reduce batch sizes. Large batch sizes seem efficient, but they require a lot of work in progress. In manufacturing, this means running each phase sequentially, and this produces a large inventory of unfinished product. Similarly, in software, this means a large number of unfinished tasks. This is inherently less flexible, because changes in requirements may require us to adjust or maybe even redo all the things we've already started. With large batch sizes, the lead time to the customer is increased. With small batch sizes, we finish work sooner and we have a lower risk of wasted effort. 4. Reduce the number of handoffs. When work passes from team to team or person to person, scheduling, communication, coordination needs to happen. Not only is every handoff an opportunity for mistakes to happen, if the work isn't picked up immediately downstream, it ends up waiting, meaning more unfinished work in progress. To reduce the number of handoffs, it's recommended to have a generalist team, T-shaped team members. 5. Find and fix bottlenecks. With visible work able to show us exactly where work is piling up, we can find and focus our attention on that and only that. Trying to improve the flow in any other location in the pipeline just won't give us the benefits. Sometimes the workload is just highly variable. QA might be waiting for work some days and then drowning in it on others. This shows that there's a disturbance in the efficiency of the flow. 6. Eliminate hardships and waste. Tell me if you recognize any of these. Extra work unrelated to the value of the customer. Long unproductive meetings, extra features prioritized over more important work, also known as gold plating, frequent task switching, waiting on others, heroics, like needing to work overtime, weekends, nights, just to get things done. Obviously, these things need to be eliminated, and doing so will improve the flow. There are a lot of details in the book, and I skipped over a lot of them, and I only talked about flow. The sections on feedback, continuous learning, and security have similar lists of practices, and they're great. All of these practices play off each other, and I think if you have most of them in place, a sort of synergy could be established. A lot of these things we know, yet somehow they feel hard to implement. Maybe there's a tendency to buckle under the pressure of deadlines. Or perhaps we feel that it's not our place to make these changes. It's a question I've been thinking about the last few months. It's my job to take these practices and incorporate them into the Worth process model and start pushing to make them our standard. In doing so, I'm counting on everyone's support. Thanks for watching and see you soon.